Wake up and keep awake.
The time has come. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. I must pray. Father. I know. It must be as you will it. Father, take this from me. Spare me.
Lord, I know you are pleased with me, for you sustain me in sincerity.
We thank you, our ancestors, for watching over us.
Father.
Praise the Lord, God of Israel, everlasting and everlasting. Amen and amen.
If you will it, Father. If you will it, your will is mine. Do what you came for.
The message today will be entitled, Jesus' Suffering and Your Suffering. Most Christians understand that having faith in God, and trusting in God, and Jesus, and having faith in Jesus as being the Son of God is something that's of vital importance to everyone who calls themselves a believer. But what about this thing called suffering? Is suffering as vital to our walk with God as having faith and believing that Jesus is Lord? According to Scripture, it is. And we want to look at a passage of Scripture this morning to start things off with in Philippians chapter 1, verse 29. It says, for you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for Him. Paul goes on to say later that when tough times come along, that we shouldn't be surprised, like, wow, I never expected these trials and these tough times to come along. And Paul tells us that when they come along, we shouldn't look at them as being unexpected or to be surprised by them. And he goes on to say that we should embrace them as it makes us literally to be friends of God, to be partners with God. Let's look at that passage of Scripture in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 12 through 13. It says, dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trials that you are going through, as if something strange was happening to you. Instead, be, say it with me, very glad, for these trials make you partners with Christ in His, say, suffering. So that you will have the wonderful joy of seeing His glory when it is revealed to all of the world. Paul here tells us to be very glad when tough times come along. And the book of Philippians that we just read says to count it as a privilege when we suffer. When we're smack dab in the middle of suffering, the first thing that we want to do, natural inclination, is to pray it out. Get rid of the suffering. Let's pray away this suffering. But when you look at Scripture, and when you think about life, when somebody gives you a privilege, you usually don't try to pray the privilege away. You embrace the privilege. You enjoy the privilege. And this is what Scripture is trying to teach us here this morning. Here we are in the year 2014, which we could classify as being modern Christianity. And in our modern times, you begin to see that modern Christianity is beginning to teach us kind of a new way to follow Christ. To me, you could almost say that we've kind of repackaged things just a bit. We've repackaged the call to follow God as being smooth, trouble-free, filled with opportunities and promises, but lacking risk, passion, and sacrifice. And is that what Christ really came to die for? Jesus never said that following him was going to be a safe thing. He never said that religion was going to be the safe way. Because Jesus beckons his followers, I believe, to go along a road that I wouldn't necessarily call being an easier road. It's a path filled with adventure, uncertainty at some times, but with unlimited possibilities. It's the only path that can truly fulfill the deepest needs of a human being. God is the only one, the only way that can make you be truly alive. He desires you to be consumed by the presence of a compassionate and a loving God. And he wants you to go wherever he leads you to go, no matter the cost. I want to read another passage of Scripture to you today found in John chapter 21, verses 18 through 23. It says, "Verily, verily, I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go." Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, "Follow me." And before I read this next part in this passage of Scripture, I just want to point out to you here that Jesus is telling Peter that there was a day where you were able to come and go as you pleased and you're free, but a day is going to come where you are going to be taken captive and you're going to spread your arms wide. And he was signifying crucifixion, that Peter would soon be crucified. But history tells us that he was crucified upside down rather than straight up because he didn't want to be compared to Jesus. In other words, he's telling him that you will die because you follow me. And then he goes on to say in verse 20, Peter turned and saw the disciple whom Jesus loved, who was following them. I love it that John, who's writing this, classifies himself as being the one that Jesus loved, but isn't that how Jesus is? Every one of us in this room today feels special. We feel that Jesus loves us more than anyone else, but that's the beauty of the gospel, and it's true because Jesus does love you so much. I'm going to skip the part in parentheses there because this is just John talking about himself in the third person. And then in verse 21, when Peter saw him, when he saw John, he said, "Lord, what about him?" Jesus answered, "If I want him to remain alive until I return, what is that to you? You must follow me." Peter had a human moment. That's why I like Peter so much. Peter is the one that I relate to the most because he was fully human and fully on fire for God at the same time. He just learns of his impending death because of the sacrifice and how he's going to follow Christ. And rather than him embracing the moment and contemplating the moment, he begins to look at somebody else. It's human nature, right? Well, if I'm going to suffer, well, you didn't say nothing about him, but what's going to happen to him? Jesus pretty much tells him in modern day terms, don't worry about him. I've got that under control. But he tells him a key word that I want you to hear this morning, where he says, Peter, you must follow me. Don't worry about John. Don't worry about what's getting ready to happen to you. Just look to me. Follow me. And when you look at this passage of Scripture and you look at beginning to get that terminology of following him and what it means to follow him, I truly believe that right here, we learn that following Christ is not a cattle call. And just because God has done something in another person's life does not necessarily mean that that's what God is going to do in your life. Because God is doing a new thing in your life. He's doing something else for you. You are a masterpiece. You are uniquely made by God. And your path is your path and your path alone. And where God chooses to lead you will not be where he may lead me. He's going to lead you down another path that he hasn't led me, because God has created you to do something specifically for your life and for your end of the world. Jesus' response to Peter is as straightforward as it can get. And it is, if you want John to live and die, what is that to you? You must follow me. So you are uniquely and wonderfully made. And your calling today is to follow Christ and to follow him alone. Yeah, can we look at the examples of other people and allow it in us to encourage us and to glean and learn from it? Most certainly. But don't try to emulate the path of another person, because your path is the path that God has created you to go on, and you must do what? You must follow him. In other words, he's saying, Peter, let me lead you. Look to me, and I'll take you down that path. How many of you guys have seen the movie Rocky III? It's a classic movie, and there's one part of the movie. Remember his fight manager, Mickey? Mickey was a kind of a brash guy, and he said something to Rocky in Rocky III. He said, the worst thing happened that can happen to any fighter. The worst thing happened to you that can happen to any fighter. And he says, you got civilized. In other words, he lost his fighter's edge. And Christianity, I feel, Pastor Paul, that we become maybe a little bit too civilized. That we've become a civilized religion that I almost liken it to insurance plans. For those of you who work in corporate America and you have a company that has an insurance plan, and your company goes to these other insurance companies and they've negotiated a group plan for you. And there's different plans within your company that you can choose from. And I believe that the church today, we've kind of went out and negotiated this plan with God, and it's a group plan. And we all have the same package. And of course, that package is the premium package. The plan to get rich, to get comfortable, to get secure, to get safe, and get well when you get God. Not too many of us choose the Peter package. Most of us choose the John package. That's the package that we want to choose, because as a civilized faith, that kind of package gets us through life without risk. It gives us safety. But what's ironic is that when you look back to the first church, and you look back to what Jesus was talking to the first church back, and we serve a God who's the same yesterday, today, and forever. And he spoke to the first church differently than I see a lot of civilized religion conducting themselves today. Hebrews chapter 11 is something that a lot of us know. It's called the Heroes of Faith, the Hall of Faith. And I'm going to read to you Hebrews chapter 11, verses 1 through 2. It says that faith is the confidence that we hope for will actually happen. It gives us assurance about things that we cannot see. Through faith, the people in days of old earned a good reputation. Throughout this chapter, the writer talks to us about the vitality, about the power of people that we read about in Scripture of the past. And he called out names such as Abel, names that we all know: Enoch, Noah, Abraham, Joseph, Moses, Samson, David. And then he goes on to summarize some of their exploits. Look at Hebrews chapter 11, verses 33 through 35. He's talking about the Noahs of the world, the Moseses of the world. He says, by faith, these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and they escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weaknesses was turned to strength, and they became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. And women received their loved ones again back from death. And this is the stuff that we think of when we think of people who have faith. When we live by faith, we think that people don't die by the sword. When we live by faith, every single battle is won. When we live by faith, the mouths of lions are shut. When we live by faith, executioners become unemployed and the Grim Reaper's projects become slim. But faith doesn't stop there. Wish it did. It would make things and life so much easier. But I'm here this morning to tell you that faith only starts there. You see, this is the short list of people of faith. And by short, I mean it's really the short version. It points us not to the rule, but to the exception of the rule. You see, these men and women are listed because they lived extraordinary lives, and their results were unbelievably unusual. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that we don't serve a God who's a God of the unexpected, because he is. We serve a God of the unusual because he can do unusual things, and he can do them suddenly. But what I'm saying is it doesn't just stop there, because it's just getting started. Now, Hebrews goes on in verse 35 through 39 to talk about some other heroes of faith. And let's read that. But others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection. Some were jeered at, and their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in prison. Some died by stoning. Some were sawed in half. Others were killed by the sword. Some went about wearing skins of sheep and goats, destitute and oppressed and mistreated. They were too good for this world, wandering over deserts and mountains and hiding in caves and holes in the ground. And all of these people earned a good reputation because of their faith, yet none of them received all that God had promised, and they will someday. For God has something better in mind for us so that they would not reach perfection without us. Who are the others mentioned in verse 39? Look at verse 35. Look at the word "these people" in verse 39. Who are the others? Who are these people? We don't know. But the one thing that we do know is we know how faith worked out in their lives. But after all, isn't that what Jesus was preparing us for when he told his disciples in John chapter 15, verses 18 through 20, you'll see it in overhead. If the world hates you, remember that it hated me first. The world will love you as one of its own if it belonged to you, but you are no longer part of the world. I chose you to come out of the world, so it hates you. Do you remember what I told you? A slave is not greater than the master. And since they persecuted you, what does it say? They will naturally persecute you. And if they listened to me, they would listen to you. Both groups in Hebrews chapter 11 were commended for their faith. Although the first group of believers, their names will be known throughout history, and we will always talk about them. But this other group, equally people of faith, we don't know their names, and their names remained nameless. Why? Because I believe that there were so many of them. So many people that were persecuted. So many people that suffered, that there wasn't enough room on the pages of the Bible to list them person by person by person. And it doesn't mean that their faith was any lesser. They trusted Jesus with their lives. They trusted God with their lives, and they lost it because of their belief on him, because of their faith. God created you so that your life would count. Not that you could count the days of your life. God wants you to count in what you do while you live here on this earth. But I wonder how many of us that are sitting here today, or how many that may not be in this place today, that have become bitter because they feel like they've suffered so much and they don't understand why. But there is hope for them. There is hope for you today. And we're going to talk about that again in just a few more minutes. But is it possible that we as a church have lost our transforming power because we've tried to play it too safe, and because we're not willing to suffer the gospel of Jesus Christ? Let's look at Romans chapter 3, and there's a reason for our suffering. There's a reason for our struggles. And if we look at Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5, it says, "Not only so, but we glory in our suffering because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character produces hope." When we begin to go through tough times, and we begin to go through the trials and the tribulations, and we begin to suffer, God is trying to create us to persevere. And when we persevere, and when we hang in there, it begins to build our faith. Because look, you're a masterpiece. God wants to do something special for you. But in order for you to get to the place where God wants you to get, he has to send you through the fire sometimes to refine you. But when you're going through the fire And God is trying to make you and mold you and make you the person that he's called you to be. When you're going through that tough time, he wants you to persevere, to hang in there, and to believe. And when we hang in there and we believe, the next thing it leads to is character. Because after we persevere and after we hang in and we hang tough and we keep believing, he begins to build character in us. And that character begins to help us to become the people, to become the thing that God has created you to be as a person. And again, I'm talking to you today as individuals. And God is going in there. He's put you through the fires. You've persevered. Now you're beginning to build the character. You're becoming the person that God has called you to be. And the next thing he does, he gives you hope. Because then all of a sudden you begin to believe in something better. And you know there's a higher calling than just to be another person, but to be something that God has at work in. Because God is the one who enables every one of us. Remember the day that Gabriel came to Mary and he said, "Hey, you're going to have a baby. His name's going to be Jesus. He's going to be the Messiah." Mary was like, "Time out. Well, what you talking about, Willis? This is impossible. I'm a virgin. I can't be having a baby. And this is what I want you to get today." Look at Luke chapter 1, verses 34 through 35. It says, Mary asked the angel, "How can this happen? I'm a virgin." And the angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you, so that the baby will be born holy, and he will be called the Son of God." Mary said, "How can this be?" And Gabriel gave her a two-part answer. He said, "The Holy Spirit is going to come upon you so that you can do something that no one else could do but God. He's going to empower. He's going to empower you." Mary knew that she couldn't do it on her own. And a lot of you are here this morning that don't think that you can do it on your own. And I'm here today to tell you that you're right. You can't do it on your own. But God has given you the power of the Holy Spirit to help you persevere and to get you to move forward. Look what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 8 through 9. He says, "You think you ought to know, dear brothers and sisters, about the trouble that we went through in the province of Asia. We were crushed and overwhelmed beyond our ability to endure, and we thought that we could never live through it. In fact, we expected to die. But as a result," here's what I want you to get. I want you to read this part with me. Read this when I start. "We stopped relying on ourselves and learned to rely on God who raises the dead." How many of you have been to that place before where you didn't think that you could endure one more day? And I believe that there are people that are sitting here this morning that don't believe that you can go on any longer with the trials and the tribulations that you're suffering through this morning. And you feel just as Paul said here, he felt crushed and he felt overwhelmed. The problem got so big that he felt powerless. And then what did he say? What did he say he did? "We stopped relying on ourselves and we begin to rely on God." Because when you know when God is the strongest, Paul said it, and it's not going to be in your overhead here. Paul once said that, "I have a thorn in my side, and I prayed three times for God to remove the thorn from his side, and the Lord told him three times, 'My grace is all you need. My power is strongest when you are weak.'" You see, Mary didn't understand how she could deliver a baby by being a virgin. But rather than arguing with God, rather than trying to go toe-to-toe with God, she submitted. And she said, "Okay." And God is calling us here this morning to begin to submit to him. and allow him to empower you, to give you the strength that you need to have in order to persevere. The last passage of scripture I'm going to read, and Kenneth, you can come up, is John chapter 16, verse 33. It says, I have told you these things. This is Jesus talking. He says, I have told you these things so that in me, who? In me, that you may have peace. In this world, you will have what? Trouble. But take heart. I have overcome the world. Is it a surprise that we suffer? Should it be a surprise that we have trials and tribulations? Jesus told us right here in Scripture that troubles were going to come. But folks, the greatest literature sold in our bookstores today is all about the blessings. It's all about prosperity. It's all about the good things, the fluff. And those things aren't wrong. But that's all that's not to it. The whole story hasn't been told. I was watching TV the other day, and one of the most prominent ministers on our planet said that if you're sick, then you're cursed by God because something's going on in your life. He said if you're suffering, there's sin in your life and you need to get rid of it. Scripture doesn't teach me that. Scripture teaches me that we all have struggles. We all go through things that we don't understand. Tim, I don't know why. I've been looking for a job for months and I haven't found a job. Tim, I've been having issues with my family, with my kids. I'm having issues in my marriage. I'm having issues in my body. I just don't understand. What am I doing wrong? You're not doing nothing wrong. You live in a fallen world and you are going to suffer. And for those of you who stand for God, you're going to suffer because of him. But God will see you through. He is the one who enables you. The problem that we have is during our suffering, we just start trying to rely on ourselves to find the answer. But Jesus wants you to start relying on him today during your times of suffering, during your times of tribulation. We're all trying to pray it out rather than saying, okay, God, you've got me going through this. What are you trying to get me to go through? What are you trying to get me to understand? And I believe a lot of the answers to this is God saying, I want you just to rely on me. Rely on me. You're not coming to me the way that I want you to. I want you to get desperate for me. I want you to get desperate for me to make a difference. So today, as Kenneth ministers to us in song, I want all of us to begin to ask God to give us strength during our times of suffering and to begin to rely on him, because God's doing a work in you right now. You don't understand what God's trying to do, but he's trying to do something. And some of us won't really understand it until we get to the other side. And Scripture tells us that we're going to look back on this earth, we're going to look back at all the trials and tribulations, and we're going to say, it was worth it all because it got me here. See, to be a Christian, you got to kind of be visionary. You got to have long-term vision. So believe that he's doing great things in your life.